In fact, this is our starting of ambitious presidential action plan of Dr. Sanjeev sir, with the great support and vision of our UPIAP pillars, Dr. Vineet Saxena sir and Dr. Sandeep Agarwal sir. Yesterday, Dr. Girish Gupta sir gave an excellent talk on the basics and decision making while giving respiratory support, which was highly appreciated. So let us place them to nurture a platform where we foster our academics with camaraderie and dedicate ourselves for the welfare of our children. Our participants are very, very enthusiastic and we always need their support and suggestions. Yeah. Before we start today's proceedings, I would like to thank DREV and its country head, Mr. Vinay Joshi, for collaborating with UPIAP and providing technical and operational support to this ambitious program. Now, I request Mr. Vinay Joshi to please give brief about technical operations of this web platform.
Thank you so much, Dr. Om, for your kind words. Before I talk about, you know, some of the operational stuff, I just wanted to briefly talk about DREV and our mission. Yesterday, I spoke about what is our mission, and today I just wanted to tell you how we do it. We have very extensive experience in conducting human-centered design to achieve our mission. And the core of our work involves interviews and meetings with doctors, not only in cities, but also at the periphery to understand local needs that could improve patient outcomes in underserved populations. And we also conduct studies around the high need technological intervention, which helps us to address and, you know, timely implement solutions to the challenges which are faced by the doctors and nurses in the various hospitals. And that's why we started this online platform for sharing, between doctors, their best practices and learn from each other. ECHO, our partner in this, also has similar mission. They have a very unique collaborative model around medical education and care management that empowers clinicians everywhere and to bring the proper care to the patient where they actually live instead of referred to the bigger center. Some of the Zoom security features, I know a lot of people are anxious about Zoom these days, but I just want to assure everyone that AOP, UP and DREV has used the license copy of Zoom and has enhanced security around this and want to protect your privacy at all times. That's why we only allow registered participants, and I have been telling everyone that please use your first name and the roll number and all the unique ID what we have generated for you, so that we can identify who are the people who actually belong to this group and will be able to find out people who do not. You will not be able to unmute yourself. I'm sorry for that, but this is to maintain the noise in the session so that everyone will be able to hear the speaker properly. And you will not be able to share the screen as well, so that no explicit material can be shared around. Some of the steps to rename yourself: go into participant, click on your name and rename yourself into the format which I already told you. If you're not able to hear us, obviously you'll not be able to hear right now also, but you can go to WhatsApp group and see, you know, how to actually hear what's going on in this session. Some of the best practices: move into a steady internet connection so that you can take maximum out of this session. If you have questions from faculties, which obviously we will take in the end, the moderators will take the questions with the faculties at the end of the session, please send the messages privately to me and I will forward your questions to the moderator, and they will select and choose some of the questions and will be and the faculties will take the questions at the end. Very important, it is all teach, all learn motto and judgment-free zone. If you do not agree with some of the points of the speaker of the day, please be respectful about it, and you can always raise your opinion on the WhatsApp group later. Shalabji, you want to take this?
Yeah. Before I hand over the proceeding to our moderator, Dr. Ruchira Gupta, I request Dr. Basavraj sir, our Honorary Secretary General, who is the most visible face on the lockdown period among all the pediatricians, the star or HSD, to your presence is a big boost. Please say a few words. Will be encouraged.
Good evening to all the participants. I bring a greetings from Indian Academy of Pediatrics on behalf of Team 2020. First of all, let me thank IAP UP branch using this lockdown period to a most productive period by organizing a neonatal ventilation training program under the leadership of Dr. Sanjeev Kumar, President, Secretary Dr. Om Prakash Chaurasia, President-elect Dr. Shalar, our immediate past President Dr. Piyali Bhattacharya, all the leaders of Indian Academy of Pediatrics. This program, I am sure, is conceptualized by our none other than our our past Vice President of Central IAP and is a more active person in the Indian Academy of Pediatrics, working behind the screen, that is Dr. Vineet Saxena ji. Thank you so much, Dr. Vineet Saxena sir, conceptualizing and organizing, motivating the most needed program. And most important today, I know this, all the faculties going, I went through all the program sheet, the conceptualization of respiratory support in the neonatal ventilation. How do we optimize the ventilation? When to ventilate? Before the ventilation, can we have any other therapy like in the HFNC, CPAP? After ventilation, what are the terminologies? How do we monitor the ventilated child? And how do we troubleshooting? And how do we wean the things? And ABG, all are within a 6 days of the program. This is something which is unique, covering all the aspects of ventilation. I really thank Professor Girish Gupta sir for Girish Gupta sir led faculty. And coming to the today's program, today's moderator Ruchira Gupta is a dynamic chief organizing secretary of our Pedicar. She is known for a good academic things. She is moderating the things. Wish you all the best, Ruchira, with today's faculty, Dr. Akan Pandita. He is going to talk on optimizing oxygen therapy in the neonate and HFNC. We know as a pediatric intensivist, HFNC is a game changer in the management of a bronchiolitis. Similar way, how it will be useful in an neonate, that's the most important thing. So the faculties from the SGPGA is going to do that. And Dr. Akanshana Verma, she's going to talk about a practical concepts of CPAP in a neonate. Without wasting much time, I don't want to waste that, come in between the scientific program at this inauguration. I wish you all the best. I know there are more than 288 members right now, 289 members right now. I wish you all the participants to please make use of this. It is a unique program. Last but not the least, the technical support team led by Vinay Joshi, DRAV team. Thank you. Thank you for collaborating with our IAP UP branch. Thank you. Thank you very much. Wish you all the best for the success of this neonatal training workshop. Thank you and all.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
HSD, sir, Dr. Basavraj, it's a great boost. Your words of encouragement. And you have done half of my job introducing dynamic power lady of IFP. And we are so fortunate that she belongs to UP, Dr. Ruchira Gupta, who is me moderating the session. She has graduated and postgraduate from Jawaharlal Nehru Medical College, Aligarh. She's been practicing in Noida for the last 15 years. She's a consultant, senior consultant in Kailash Hospital, Noida. She has been a two-time and current representative of UP at the National Executive Board. And as you all know that she's a chief organizing secretary of UPIP and a very active member of the NRP in a pillar. Now, without any further time, I invite Dr. Ruchira to take over the proceedings.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. And thanks for the kind word, Dr. Shalab, sir. At the outset, I would like to thank Academy of Pediatrics Uttar Pradesh's leadership of Dr. Sanjeev Kumar, Dr. Shalab Agarwal, Dr. Piyali Bhattacharya, Dr. Vineet Saxena, sir, and Dr. Om Chaurasia, the Secretary General of Uttar Pradesh IAP, for giving me this opportunity of sharing this platform with the august audience. Dear IAPians, as we know, oxygen supplementation using non-invasive measures is an important component of neonatal intensive care unit. Therefore, careful monitoring is required to minimize pulmonary toxicity and consequences of hyperoxia and hypoxemia. So, therefore, the importance of today's topic, that is optimizing oxygen therapy in units and HHHFNC, is of utmost importance in day-to-day practice. For this, we have none other than Dr. Akash Pandita from SGPGI. Dr. Pandita, Dr. Pandita is from SGPGI. He has got 10 years of experience in the field of neonatology. He has done MD and DNB neonatology, and he is currently his designation is currently as assistant professor of SGPGI Medical Institute. He has done formal research neonatology fellowship with Queen Elizabeth Trust UK. He has more than 100 international publications to his credit, and his special interests are in field of neonatal jaundice, affect and non-invasive ventilation research and teaching. So without causing further delay, I request Dr. Akash Pandita to take over and start the deliberation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Is my screen visible?
Not yet, sir.
No?
One more announcement I would like to make, that there will be two questions which will be coming on your screen, and you have to answer the correct option, whatever you feel like. And the same questions will come on your screen once the session is over, once our speaker has completed his session. And then you have to again answer the thing. This is going to show us the impact of this teaching on today's session.
Is my screen visible?
Yeah. Not yet, sir. You have to clear not the share screen on the bottom of your screen.
Yeah, I've done that.
And then you have to choose your presentation or desktop, or you know, whatever the option it says. What option it is showing you?
1 minute. Is it visible?
No, sir. I'm relaunching the poll. There was some mistake. I think it was ended by some of the co-hosts. Please reply again.
It has come
up. Is it visible?
Yeah.
Yes. Please don't close this. Don't hit on the end poll. Just let it be until people reply. Please, whoever has already replied, please again do it. We could not record your response earlier.
Is the screen visible?
Yes, sir, it is. Yes. You can start now.
Can we start?
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am, for your kind words. Esteemed faculty members and dear friends, a very warm welcome to day two of this unique virtual neonatal ventilation workshop, a first of its kind. Yesterday, after deciding about the mode of respiratory support, today we'll be discussing about heated, humidified, high-flow nasal cannula in neonates. Before going to the main presentation, we would like to enumerate a few points about optimal oxygen utilization in neonates. The journey of oxygen started way back in 1772 when it was first discovered, but it took us almost 15 years to know about its potential and use in babies with respiratory distress. As people began to use it, they came to know that oxygen is a drug, and like any other drug, it has got certain untoward side effects if it is not used properly and judiciously. So people began to observe various morbidities associated with oxygen use, such as increased risk of cerebral palsy, increased ROP. Subsequently, researchers began to limit oxygen delivery to the neonates, but after limiting the oxygen delivery, there was increase in the mortality. For every one baby who was saved for ROP, there were increased death rates by 17. This was because of the increased oxygenation, which leads to free radical injury and almost affects each and every organ of the body. Subsequently, in 1993, there were two landmark trials known as RESAIR 1 and RESAIR 2, that is resuscitation with room air in asphyxiated neonates, which emphasized that it is better to resuscitate these neonates with room air rather than using 100% oxygen, which was norm at the time. Using room air for resuscitation leads to decreased morbidity and mortality. Subsequently, it became as a part of LCOR guidelines in 2010. And by now we know that for preterm babies less than 35 weeks, we should use FiO2 between 21 to 30% for initial delivery room resuscitation. And for more than 35 weeks, we should start with room air. And lately we had a prospective meta-analysis, the famous NeoProm study, which was a prospective meta-analysis, a first of its kind. Usually meta-analyses are retrospective. That is, the studies have already taken place, the results are already out. Then we collate them and get a pooled estimate. But in prospective meta-analysis, the studies which are still recruiting the babies, they are taken into this meta-analysis and results are not yet out, and neither they are published. This is done to overcome bias like reporting bias, publication bias, selection bias. So it becomes like a large multi-center RCT and the results are more valid. NeoProm study told us that how important it is to target saturation, and the target saturation for newborns is between 90 to 95% irrespective of gestation age. We all know that any baby who is admitted under our care, it is our duty to maintain him under normoxemia. That is, his partial pressure should be between 50 and 70. Any deviation from this, that is both hypoxia and hyperoxia, can be detrimental. We know that hypoxia, that is PO2 of less than 50 millimeters of mercury, can lead to lethargy, bradycardia, shock. This is because of the ischemopathy. Ischemia of the organs can lead to organ damage, and when more than one organ is involved, it can lead to death. Similarly, hyperoxia, that is PO2 more than 70, leads to vasoconstriction of the cerebral and retinal vessels. Because of the vasoconstriction, there is ischemic damage leading to increased retinopathy of prematurity and BPD. It is also known to cause post-asphyxial brain injury, which is also called as reperfusion injury, and is typically seen in cases with HIE. So remember, my friends, that oxygen is a double-edged sword. If you do not pick a baby with hypoxia timely and do not manage it properly, he is going to have ischemic organopathy in the form of NEC, PPHN, persistent of ductus arteriosus, PVL, that is periventricular leukomalacia. And if a baby who is on oxygen, we do not monitor that oxygen and let the baby go into hyperoxia, it is going to cause increased retinopathy of prematurity, lung morbidity in the form of bronchopulmonary dysplasia and impaired neurodevelopment outcome. So the main point from this slide is, remember that oxygen is a drug and it is not a tonic. So use it judiciously and appropriately. The war against free radical injury, we can either win or lose right in the delivery room. Why? Because we should always start resuscitation for babies who are near term with room air, and babies who are less than 35 weaker, we should start between 21 to 30%. If we use higher oxygen, there is increased morbidity as well as mortality. And more than CPAP machines and ventilators, we require blenders to titrate this oxygen therapy and give only that much of FiO2, which is required to maintain a normal saturation between 90 to 95%. We also require to monitor this oxygen therapy. For any baby using oxygen, it is duty, we are duty bound to monitor his saturation with the help of pulse oximeter, which is attached usually to the right arm. And we should always target a saturation between 90 to 95%. These two equipments are must for any neonatal intensive care unit. Without these two basic equipments, it is almost a crime to treat a baby with respiratory distress. So my clinical recommendation for optimal use of oxygen is always avoid hypoxia and hyperoxia. Please use blenders in your units. Begin resuscitation with room air for term and near term babies. For preterm neonates, we can use between 21 to 30%. And for any baby who is on oxygen, please monitor his oxygen by pulse oximetry and always target saturation between 90 to 95%. You should empower your nursing staff to monitor these babies who are having hypoxia or hypoxic episodes, and each pulse oximeter should have two alarm limits. The lower limit should be set at 89 and the higher limit should be at 95%. The nursing staff should answer these alarms. They should see the baby and take appropriate actions. So coming to the main presentation, the next part of the presentation, we'll be discussing about HHFNC. I will be discussing my presentation under the following headings. Now, before moving further, do you really think that despite having n number of modes for non-invasive ventilation, do we require another gadget? What was the need of HFNC? Despite having a backbone, a therapy like CPAP, which has served neonatal care for last 4 or 5 decades. Before you answer this question, let me remind you that despite CPAP being the backbone of the respiratory care in neonatology, 40 to 50% of the babies fail CPAP and they require ventilation in the first 7 days of life. CPAP in itself is associated with various complications like nasal trauma in up to 40% of the babies. And CPAP has got a huge interface which interferes with nutritive sucking, bonding, KMC. And we know that these modalities are important for intact survival of our neonates, especially preterm neonates. Also, CPAP therapy is labor intensive. It requires 24/7 monitoring, and it may not be feasible to monitor a baby 24/7 in smaller units and secondary care units. Therefore, we say that necessity is the mother of invention. Therefore, it led to the invention of a new device called as HHFNC, sometimes also called as H3FNC, which causes less nasal trauma, requires less intensive nursing care. It does not interfere with KMC, does not interfere with nutritive sucking, and it improves bonding between the mother and the child, leading to HFNC. Because of the simple interface and ease of use, the HFNC first began to be used in neonatal care around 2002, and subsequently within 2 years, it overpassed CPAP, and now HFNC is the most common oxygen or respiratory support used in neonatal intensive care units around the globe, such as its popularity. Now, what is this HHFNC? By HHFNC, we mean that we are giving a high flow, which for a neonate means more than 1 liter per minute, which is heated at around 34 to 37 degrees Celsius and is humidified at around 100% relative humidity. And we give this high flow heated humidified oxygen with the help of this smaller binasal prongs to a baby, and it's known as HHFNC. The main mechanism of action for HFNC is that it flushes out the nasopharyngeal dead space. It also reduces inspiratory work or breathing. It provides a distending pressure, although the pressures generated are less than those generated in CPAP. It decreases the metabolic cost of gas conditioning, and it provides oxygen to the baby with respiratory distress. Now, coming to the nasopharyngeal dead space washout, we know during inspiration, we breathe in oxygen through our nose, which goes into the lungs and alveoli and takes part in ventilation and oxygenation. And during exhalation, the CO2 is taken up from the blood and the lungs exhale it through the nose. In subsequent breaths, because there is the anatomical dead space, by anatomical dead space, we mean part of the airway, that is nose, nasopharynx, larynx, trachea, part of bronchi, which do not take part in ventilation. That is, they are functionally dead. this becomes, especially the nasopharynx, they become rich in carbon dioxide. Now, during subsequent breaths, when the baby has to breathe, he has the oxygen has to go through this nasopharyngeal dead space, which is rich in oxygen. For a baby who is otherwise healthy, this is not a tedious job. But a baby, especially preterm babies, whose lungs are not healthy, moving oxygen across this dead space increases the work of breathing. It increases the resistance and leads to CO2 retention. Now, what does the HFNC do? HFNC, by providing high flow, which is equal to the peak inspiratory flow, it washes out this CO2 from the nasopharynx through nose as well as mouth. So the space, which was rich in CO2, now becomes rich in oxygen. This oxygen is now available for the alveoli for oxygenation and ventilation. It has been seen that HFNC improves both oxygen and ventilation, and this is independent of the pressure it generates in a baby. The other mechanisms include, we know that nasopharynx is the part of this respiratory system which offers the highest resistance. Now, HFNC, like CPAP, it distends the airway, therefore increases the diameter of the airway and decreases the resistance. By providing a peak inspiratory flow, thereby it decreases resistance and work of breathing. Normally, our respiratory passage, our nasopharynx, is equipped to humidify and volumify the inhaled gases we take during inhalation. But whenever the flows exceed more than 1 liter, this normal mechanism of humidification and vormication, which is naturally provided in our nasopharynx, it gets overwhelmed. So the body is unable to humidify and vormify any flow which is more than 1 liter. HFNC, by providing ready-made humidification and vormification, decreases the resistance. It improves the ciliary clearance of the nasopharynx airways. It prevents drying of the secretions, which can lead to mucosal erosion, bleeding, and increases of sepsis. By providing a ready-made source of humidification and vormification, it decreases the metabolic need of the body. Now, what about pressures? Does HFNC generate a continuous distending pressure like CPAP? Yes, we know by Poiseuille's equation that whenever a flow encounters a resistance, a pressure is generated. So HFNC does generate a pressure, but this pressure is highly variable and it depends on certain factors such as flow, that is flow used in relation to the size of the baby. By this, we mean that same flow in a smaller baby will generate higher pressures compared to the flow, same flow used in a bigger baby. Also, the pressure used generated depends on the resistance, that is the size of the prongs in relation to the nose and the leak in and around the nose as well as the mouth. Now, coming to this diagram on the left, this is the nasal cavity and this is the nasal cannula of HFNC. Usually, the nasal cannula should not occupy more than 50% of the nares diameter. It is also known as prongs nares ratio. If you try to occlude more than 50%, there will be higher pressures, and these higher pressures can be transmitted to the pleural space and there can be air leaks. So always ensure that the nasal cannula of HFNC should not occupy more than 50% of the inner nares diameter. Now, about the opening and closure of the mouth. On the left-hand side, when the mouth is fully open, you can see on the x-axis there is HFNC flow rate, and on the y-axis, it shows the pressure generated in centimeters of water. For a flow of 6 liters, if the mouth is open, we hardly generate a pressure of around 2 centimeters of water. Whereas on the diagram on the right-hand side, at the same flow of 6 liters, when the mouth is closed, the pressures can be reached up to a maximum of 20 centimeters of water. So you can see the variability of the pressure generated in HFNC. Generally, it is believed that the pressure generated is proportional to the flow rate. As the flow rate increases, the pressure generated also increases. Usually, it is said that we require a flow of around 4 to 6 liters to generate a pressure of around 5 to 6. It is because of this reason, whenever we start the HFNC therapy, we start in the flow rates of 4 to 6, because this is the minimum flow which is required to generate a pressure of 5 to 6 centimeters of water. Now, the main drawback of HNC is that the pressure generated is highly variable. Here in the diagram, you can see for a flow of 4 liters, the pressure can vary between 3 centimeters of water to 10. So there is huge variability. So whenever you are using a HFNC, please do not completely occlude the nares. If you completely occlude the nares, the leak which you are preventing at the nose, the same gas can leak into the pleural space and can cause air leak syndromes. So always ensure that the nasal cannula occupy less than 50% of the nares diameter. So the practical points one has to remember is that HFNC pressures increase with increase in flow. The pressures are inversely proportional to the weight of the baby. That is, smaller the baby, more will be the pressure generated. And there is a considerable variability of pressures between the patient and for the same patient, whether the depends on whether his mouth are open and closed. The main drawback for HFNC is that the pressures are unpredictable, because we can neither set or we can measure the pressure generated. That is the main drawback of CPAP, of HFNC compared to the CPAP. Now coming to the HFNC system. The HFNC, for HFNC system, we usually need air oxygen source. And this is machine called AirVo. It has an inbuilt humidifier. It has an inbuilt blender. And it usually can deliver an FiO2 to between 21 to 100%. It has got a display which shows the readings. It shows the temperature which we have set. It shows the flow rates which we are using and the FiO2 which we are delivering to the baby. This is the inspiratory circuit which is connected to the HFNC cannula, and the diameter should always be less than 50%. It is also important to know that for HFNC, you don't need to have a dedicated machine. The same machine which is required to deliver CPAP can be used to deliver HFNC. The thing is, for using CPAP circuit as HFNC circuit, you need to remove the expiratory circuit and connect the HFNC cannula to the inspiratory circuit. It becomes an HFNC system. The common available HFNC devices are OptiFlow Junior from New Zealand and Vapotherm and Comfort Flow, they are from the US. The common Indian devices which provide HFNC cannula are Humidifier OptiFlow Prongs and the Phoenix NCPEP FlexiCare Prongs. For selecting the nasal cannula size, usually for neonates, there are 3 sizes in the increasing order of the size, the smallest being the XS, followed by S for smaller babies, that is preterm babies, and M is for the term babies. X has been a recent addition to the AirVo 2, which is used for extremely preterm babies. Always ensure that less than 50% of the diameter is occluded. For Indian market, we have some Indian brands also, like for example, Flexi Intercare. Here I'm not promoting any brand, so I don't have any conflict of interest. This is just for general knowledge. We have Phoenix providing NCPAP machine. FlexiCare usually has cost of around 650 rupees and it comes in different sizes. We also have nice Neotech, which has got HyFlex. That is a circuit which is compatible with other ventilator circuits. And it has other cannula, HFNC cannula, which is known as MaxFlow. These are compatible only with their own machines. Now coming to the indications, there are indications almost similar to the CPAP. These include post-extubation, as a primary support for RDS, apnea of prematurity, any baby who's on CPAP and has nasal trauma, and for giving delivery room CPAP. Contraindications are very few. These include severe respiratory distress, because these babies are likely to fail HFNC if there is a significant air leak, because there is a theoretical risk of increased air leak with HFNC. If the baby who has got recurrent apnea requiring bag and mask, again, is likely to fail on HFNC, or if there is a craniofacial abnormality, because there the delivery of flow will not be possible. Remember, these days we are all surrounded by COVID. So for COVID babies, it has been shown in adult studies that HFNC can lead to significant dispersion of viruses, and it increases with increasing flow. So whenever you are using HFNC for a COVID positive baby, do not use higher flows, use low to moderate flows. The most common indication of use of HFNC around the globe is post-extubation. This is the only condition where HFNC is similar to CPAP. Multiple studies have shown that there is no difference in treatment failure defined as failure of extubation in the first 7 days of life. There is no increased mortality. In fact, HFNC is associated with significant decreased nasal trauma. It decreases nasal trauma by 35%. There's a decreased risk of pneumothorax. There's a decreased risk of severe NIC or GI perforation with HFNC. This is a forest plot. The line is called a line of null effect. Whenever this large diamond, which is the pooled effect, it touches this line of null effect, it shows that both the therapies are equal and none is superior than the other. So in fact, in the subgroup between 29 to 32 weeks of gestation, HFNC did better than CPAP. The reintubation rates with HFNC were lesser compared to CPAP. For primary support, it is good to say that HFNC is inferior to CPAP, especially in preterm babies less than 32 weeks. Here again, you will see the diamond is on the right-hand side of this null effect, and therefore it shows clear CPAP is better than HFNC when you consider the primary respiratory support for baby with RDS. Also, both the Indian studies and the international studies had to be terminated in between because there was such a remarkable difference between the two therapies. And this failure was more common in babies who had severe respiratory distress defined as SS score of more than 5 and neonates who were less than 32 weeks of gestation. So you may consider HFNC as a primary support in babies who are more than 32 weeks or babies who have mild to moderate respiratory distress. HFNC has also been compared to NIPPV, although it is a single study, but it showed good encouraging results and there was no difference in the primary outcome, although the HFNC group required longer respiratory support compared to the CPAP. A single study which evaluated HFNC compared to CPAP for apnea prematurity showed that HFNC, when used in flow rates of 1 to 2.5 liters per minute, it decreases or it is useful for treatment of apnea prematurity. There was no difference in apnea, bradycardia between the CPAP arm and the HFNC arm. So it can be used in apnea prematurity, but with a caution. Another indication is weaning from CPAP. There are four RCTs which show that HFNC can be used for a baby who is on CPAP. HFNC has been shown to decrease the duration of oxygen by almost half. It also decreases the duration of hospital stay by four difference. However, there was no difference in BPD. So remember, you can consider using HFNC for weaning a baby who is on CPAP if the baby requires prolonged CPAP support that is more than 7 days, or babies who have BPD who tend to require CPAP for a pretty long time, because HFNC will promote bonding, it will promote KMC, it will promote nutritive sucking. So in babies who are requiring CPAP more than 7 days, consider HFNC when the CPAP comes down to 5 and FiO2 comes down 30%. HFNC has also been studied for giving delivery room CPAP. In a study on 28 babies, it was shown that HFNC can be useful and it is feasible to transport babies from delivery room to HFNC without any increase in side effects such as pneumothorax, pulmonary hemorrhage, unigrade IVH, or use of inotropes. In fact, use of delivery room HFNC decreases rate of use of surfactant and ventilation. But still, there is only preliminary data. More data needs to be generated. The best thing about HFNC is that it is preferred by staff, by parents, and it is comfortable to the baby. In one of the studies where they studied CPAP and HFNC, the primary outcome was the Eden score. Eden score is a pain scale. In the HFNC group, although the pain was lesser, but it was not statistically significant. Also, the ambient noise was comparable between the HFNC and the nasal CPAP. What is commendable is that the child satisfaction contact and interaction between the baby and the mother, and the possibility of the parents taking part in the care of the baby was statistically significant in the babies who received HFNC. Also, it is important to note that the babies who were on HFNC, they had significantly lower rates of respiratory rate, thereby showing more comfort and lesser work of breathing in babies who are on HFNC. So for initiating HFNC, you need to start at a flow rate of 5 liters per minute, begin with FiO2 of 50% and adjust it according to the saturation using a preductal saturation monitor, pulse oximeter, and ensure that at least there is 50% leak in the nostril, that is prong is less than 50% of the nares diameter. You can remember rule of 5-3 for H3, that is flow of 5, FiO2 50% and leak of 50%. If there is persistent respiratory distress in the form of retractions, saturation is less than 90%, there is persistent tachypnea, go on increasing the flow rates in increments of 1 liter per minute, and we can increase it maximum up to 8 liters. Beyond 8 liters, the safety has not been studied, so never go beyond 8 liters in newborns. Safety, majority of the data does not show that HFNC increases death compared to CPAP. Also, the rates of pneumothorax were similar. In fact, in subgroups, they were lesser compared to CPAP. In some studies, there has been increased duration of oxygen. That can be explained because the weaning strategy for HFNC is still not decided. It's not universal. It is not uniform across the globe. In fact, this data shows us that HFNC, whether it is used as the primary support or it is used as post-extubation, the incidence of nasal trauma is significantly lesser with HFNC compared to CPAP. Now, when should we consider weaning a baby from HFNC? Whenever the baby's HFNC, who's on HFNC, is stable for 12 to 24 hours, start weaning FiO2 first. Do not decrease flow rates. First, come down on the FiO2. Once you have come down to FiO2 of 30%, then decrease the flow rates by decrements of 1 liter per minute every 12 to 24 hours. The point to remember here is the more premature the baby, the more gradual decline should be there. Do not go fast on decreasing the flow rates in more premature babies. Always grow slow in more premature babies. And once you reach a flow rate of 2 to 3 liters, then the HFNC can be discontinued. But during weaning of HFNC, always monitor the baby with the help of certain monitoring, objective monitoring parameters. You can use scores like Downey score, Silverman-Anderson score. And if there is any sign of increased work of breathing, you should come back to the previous flows. Do not make haste in weaning a baby from HFNC. Now, when to consider HFNC failure? If consider HFNC as a failure, if there is persistent FiO2 requirement of more than 50 to 60%, or if there is clinically increased work of breathing, baby is not maintaining on flow of 8 liters, there is persistent respiratory acidosis in the form of pH being less than 7.2, there is hypercarbia with PCO2 of more than 60%, baby is having recurrent apnea despite being on maximum settings requiring bag and mask. The point to remember in HFNC failure is whenever a baby fails HFNC, do not jump to ventilation. Always consider rescue CPAP. In majority of the large trials, it was shown that babies who fail HFNC can be managed on CPAP alone. The summary of my presentation is that whenever a baby presents with RDS, you should always consider CPAP on RNIV. However, one may consider HFNC in babies who are more than 32 weeks or have mild to moderate respiratory distress. In case there is CPAP failure, then you can consider other modes, which will be discussed in subsequent lectures, NIV and ventilation. And for post-extubation, that is, once the baby is off ventilation, CPAP, NIV, HFNC are almost comparable. You can choose any mode. And if the baby requires prolonged CPAP support, that is CPAP for more than 7 days, and once he's on minimal settings, that is a pressure of 5 and a FiO2 of 30%, you can consider HFNC. And in cases who fail HFNC, you can always manage these babies with CPAP or NIV. There is no need for ventilating these babies. Last but not the least, in present COVID times, do not let anxiety and boredom overtake you. Be the flow, challenge your ambitions, use your abilities to deliver better neonatal care. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Akash. I will just launch a post-session poll now. Please do not close it. I'm just requesting the host. Please do not close it for next 30 seconds.
So thank you, Dr. Akash, for giving a very lucid presentation. You have covered almost all the aspects of HHH, FNC, oxygenation. Your audience, we have now again same set of questions which are there. Kindly give the answers. And the next topic which we are going to discuss now is the topic of practical concepts of neonates with respiratory failure over decades has caused a lot of respiratory problems, respiratory and non-respiratory complications, especially in preterm babies. And as we know that preterm babies, they require, wherever they are born, but most of the time they have got one or other feature suggesting respiratory compromise. And early CPAP more favorable outcomes. For covering this topic, we have none other than Dr. Akanksha Verma. Dr. Akanksha Verma has done fellowship in neonatology from SGPGIMS, and she carries a 5 years experience in this field. She has formerly worked as Niku SR at Chacha Nehru Bal Chikitsalaya, New Delhi. She has 2 original articles under the review, and she has a special interest in the field of nutrition, preterm in neonates, and non-invasive ventilation neonates. So over to Dr. Akanksha, please.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the kind introduction, and a very good evening to one and all. So we shall be now moving on to our next topic, which has been very aptly introduced by ma'am, the practical concepts of CPAP in neonates.
Okay, I'm just launching the next poll now. So this will be the pre-session poll for Dr. Akanksha's session, what we are doing. And here are the questions. Just take 30 seconds to reply to this before you start listening to Dr. Akanksha. Dr. Akanksha, you can start your presentation in like another 30 seconds.
Okay.
Yeah. While you're doing the quiz, I just want to request you, if you have any questions with Dr. Akash or with Dr. Akanksha around their presentation, you can share those questions privately to me. Just write for whom this question is so that we know whom to ask it. Thank you. Okay, Dr. Akanksha, I think you can start. People will still vote. Yeah. Just put in the presentation mode, please.
So I hope it is visible now.
Yes, go ahead, please.
So good evening, one and all. The topic for my presentation would be, we will be talking about the practical concepts of CPAP in neonates. And we shall be covering this topic under the following headings. So starting with CPAP, which has been first described way back in 1970s, it has actually revolutionized the concept of respiratory care of newborns. It serves as a missing link or a bridge between the oxygen therapy and the mechanical ventilation. And it is one of the four evidence-based practices that has resulted in increased survival without any severe morbidity among very preterm infants. And as we become more and more aware of the ill effects of mechanical ventilation, there is an increasing interest in modalities such as CPAP. So before beginning, I would just like to give a brief concept about the lung protective strategies. As we all are aware that avoid BPD, so the most effective method is to avoid invasive ventilation, because that cause the ventilator induced lung injury is what is responsible for the occurrence of BPD. So the lung protective strategies revolve around the providence of optimal alveolar recruitment. They aim at prevention of alveolar collapse during the expiration to prevent, that is minimizing the atelectasis and preventing any alveolar overdistension during the inspiration. Plus, it also aims to avoid the high oxygen pressure that leads to oxidative stress, which can further damage the lung. So all of these, when our ventilation strategy revolves around this, it is a lung protective strategy, and all of these can be achieved using CPAP. So what CPAP is, it is actually a technique of respiratory support wherein there is an application of a continuous positive pressure during the entire respiratory cycle in a spontaneously breathing baby. So how does this CPAP actually help? So we all know that impaired oxygenation, which is seen in neonates with RDS, is usually explained by alveolar collapse, that is a loss of FRC or a reduced lung volume, which occurs because of inadequate surfactant system in such babies. But what actually this FRC is? FRC, or the functional residual capacity of the lung, is actually the volume of the lung which is remained, that is left in the lungs at the end of a passive expiration. And what is closing volume? We also need to know something about that. So closing volume is the volume of the lung at which the terminal airways, which are connected to the alveoli, they begin to collapse. So once they start closing, and once they get collapsed, no air can reach or go outside the alveoli. In RDS or HMD, the FRC is severely reduced. So the difference between this closing volume and FRC further increases. So this loss of FRC, or the functional residual capacity, in babies with RDS can be partially compensated by application of a positive pressure from outside. So when such a pressure is applied to the airways of spontaneously breathing infants, it will help to maintain the FRC. So CPAP actually works by increasing the FRC above the closing volume. So what this will result in, since the FRC is more than closing volume, so the tendency of the airways to collapse at the end of expiration will not occur. So we can try to understand it using this pressure time scalar, wherein we see that this is the PEEP which has been applied. So in the presence of PEEP, even at the end of the expiration, the alveoli are still, they are contracted, but they are still aerated. Rather, in
excuse me, ma'am. Just one thing. Your voice is a little low. It is actually coming from a little far. Do you have a earphone or something which you can use?
I don't have an earphone right now. Maybe I'll try to
speak. Yeah, maybe out. Come a little closer to the... Okay. All right, thanks.
We were talking about that how this application of PEEP helps us in preventing the collapse of the alveoli at the end of the expiration. Where there is no PEEP, the alveoli will get collapsed, and it is very difficult to reopen them in every cycle. So what CPAP does, it will increase the FRC and it will improve, help in recruiting the lung and will improve the ventilation perfusion, will reduce the ventilation perfusion mismatch. Not just that, it has an effect on pulmonary vascular resistance too. So as we see in this graph, wherein we have compared the pulmonary vascular resistance to the FRC, we can see the architect of the pulmonary vessels is so that the pulmonary vascular resistance is least at FRC. So if it is the, if the FRC is less, as is seen in cases of HMD, the pulmonary vascular resistance would be high. So optimum CPAP is needed to keep the lungs open at the optimal pulmonary vascular resistance so that we reduce the intrapulmonary shunting and reduce the work of breathing. So that is another way by how this increase in FRC by use means of CPAP is going to help. Now this is to show you the effect of CPAP on the compliance of the lung. So what is compliance? It is actually a change in volume per unit change in pressure. So as is evident from this pressure volume loop, that at when there is a low FRC, the pressure required to bring about a small change in volume is high. But if we optimize this using CPAP, then the compliance of the lung improves, as is seen in this pressure volume curve. Again, we can see in this diagram wherein they have, this is an animal study where they have demonstrated that this is the pressure volume curve denoting the compliance of a preterm lung, and it is actually comparable or rather better than those of that of a term unit. And the third one that we can see here is actually a pressure volume curve of a baby who has been ventilated using conventional ventilation or invasive ventilation. So it actually causes the reduction of compliance. But a CPAP will result in an improved lung compliance and better ventilation perfusion matching. Again, we can understand this, you understand the effect of CPAP using law of Laplace. The equation goes by the pressure, which is equal to 2T by R. Here, this pressure is the inward pressure, which is making the alveoli to collapse. So we aim at reducing this pressure. So we can see that if it is a smaller alveolus, as if the radius is small, the pressure which is making it, the inward pressure making the alveoli to collapse would be higher. And so it will tend to deflate into a larger alveolus. So CPAP tends to neutralize this inward collapsing pressure of the alveoli by distending these alveoli. Also, we can see the effect of surfactant using this equation. Remember the equation again, 2T by R. So T is the surface tension. If to the same lung, we provide an exogenous surfactant, which we all know will reduce the surface tension of this alveoli. So again, by reducing the surface tension, we will reduce the pressure which is making it to collapse. So actually, CPAP and surfactant both are actually working by increasing the FRC. And the net effect of both is more than additive. Hence, it is advised that early use of CPAP, if there is an FiO2 requirement of more than 30% to maintain the target saturations, consider using surfactant early, preferably within first 2 hours of birth. So they will act in a supra additive manner. So now, other than that, what other physiological effects that can CPAP can have is that it leads to dilatation of the terminal airways and stabilizes the airways. Hence, it will decrease the airway resistance and reduce the work of breathing. We have already seen that it prevents the collapse of alveoli, resulting in better recruitment and improved gas exchange. CPAP is also said to cause a conservation of surfactant by recycling or by causing improving the function of type 2 pneumocytes that we all know release surfactant. Other than that, the other effects of CPAP are that it achieves a positive intrathoracic pressure, Thus, it decreases the afterload, increases the cardiac output, as well as reduction of pulmonary vascular resistance, as we already saw. Even in mixed or central apneas, CPAP is supposed to act by stretching, by stimulating the J receptors, by stretching the lung or pleura, which will provide a positive feedback to the respiratory center by herring Bruer reflex. So CPAP works by all these mechanisms to reduce the work of breathing and increase the FRC of a baby with RDS. So advantages, what are the advantages of it over mechanical ventilation? So we have almost all the benefits that we need from ventilation. Apart from that, CPAP will rule out all the disadvantages that can be caused by mechanical ventilation, be it barotrauma, volutrauma, or biotrauma by using an endotracheal tube, which will cause the inflammation, the lung injury, or a high risk of CLD for babies on invasive ventilation. So based on these physiological principles and animal studies, we can recommend CPAP as the primary modality with or without surfactant for the treatment of babies with RDS. So with this in mind, we now move on to understand how the CPAP works. So basically, what are the parts of CPAP? It contains of a continuous flow, a source of gas wherein the oxygen and air coming from the central supply, they get blended in a blender. Then they get heated and humidifier in a humidification chamber. And then this continuous supply of gases will help generate a pressure in the circuit by various modalities, which we will discuss next. And to deliver such a system, we need a patient interface or a delivery system, that are the inspiratory, expiratory tubings. So this is a basic setup. We just need a supply, blender, humidifier, and then an interface to do that. Just a word of caution before we move ahead. Never use CPAP device without humidification and warmidification. We can be, might be doing even more harm than actually helping the baby if we are using the cold and dry gases. So never do that. The gases must be warm to at least 34 degrees Celsius in cases of CPAP, and the relative humidity should be at least 85%. So now moving on to the types of CPAP which we can have. So based on the flow of the pressure, there can be two types of CPAP system. One is a continuous flow system. As the name suggests, the flow would be constant here. The pressure would actually be generated by changing the resistance. And another one is variable flow, which we shall discuss later. So the examples of this continuous flow system are a ventilator CPAP and a bubble CPAP. So in a ventilator CPAP, the resistance is actually generated by using a PEEP valve or an expiratory valve. And we can change the pressure that is delivered by dialing, changing the or moving the knob of the expiratory valve. And the other most common modality or the most common example type of CPAP that is being used is the bubble CPAP. Here, in bubble CPAP, there is a continuous supply of gas which will pass through the nasal device, and there is a distal limb or the expiratory tubing which is placed in an underwater chamber, so that a continuous flow of gases will lead to generation of bubbles in these chamber when there is an adequate pressure being generated. So we can change the pressure or the CPAP by changing the length of immersion of the limb into this water chamber. Not just that, it is said that the bubbles that are produced in CPAP, they are transmitted as vibrations to the chest wall of the baby, and the pressure oscillations that are produced by continuous bubbling of this CPAP might actually contribute in gas exchange and help the gas exchange through the facilitated diffusion. So it has an additional effect of CPAP plus the pressure effect of pressure oscillations of the bubbles. And it has even been stated that the effect of these oscillations of the bubbles are similar to a high frequency ventilation that we use. So bubble CPAP has definite advantages over ventilator CPAP, plus it is easily available and can be indigenously made at any place. Now moving on to the next type, which is a variable flow system. As the name suggests, the flow would be variable here. And the prototype example of such a device is an infant flow driver. So the unusual thing about this system is that there is an expiratory limb which is open to the atmosphere in this type of CPAP. So how this will act, we will tell you. Before moving on, so in such a CPAP, the pressure is generated by a vary flow near the nasal interface. So there is a pressure generator which is placed inside this nasal interface, which is then connected to the nasal prongs. So how this works, we will try to understand it now. So this is an infant generator system wherein these are the prongs, and this the circle shows the generator system which is present here. So how actually the flow is variable here? So this understand this, that this is the open limb, which is expiratory limb, which is open to the atmosphere. So what happens is that apart from the constant flow of gas which is coming from the device, in this there is an additional extra flow of gas which can take place from this open limb of the atmosphere, which can so that's why it is called as variable flow. When the baby is steady, there is no spontaneous effort, the gas, which is the flow which is supplied by the ventilator, will be driven. So when there is an inspiratory effort, and especially there is a, with inspiration there is a fall in pressure that takes place. So to avoid the pressures to fall below the desired volumes, it will entrain an additional flow of gas from the atmosphere. Similarly, at the time of the expiration, what happens is that the flow, there is a Coanda effect, or there is a fluidic slip mechanism that takes place in such devices, which states that at the time of the expiration, the gas flow which is coming from the device will flip around this generator and will leave along with the exhalation gas that is coming from the baby, and it will leave and would be exhaled to the atmosphere by this open limb. So what is the advantage with this? As that we can see, the baby is expiring to an open limb which is open to the atmosphere. So it is said that the work of breathing is reduced to almost 1/4 when compared with continuous flow devices, because the baby is not breathing against a constant flow of gases. So it significantly reduces the work of breathing, especially during facilitating the expiration of the baby. And various studies have shown that when an infant flow is compared to a conventional CPAP, it results in delivery of a more reliable and a more stable pressures when compared to conventional CPAP, where the pressures could be highly fluctuating. So although there are no RCTs to prove its superiority, but the logic says that it might be of more use to neonates, and it definitely reduces the work of breathing by helping or assisting them at the time of expiration. Now coming on to various types of interfaces that can be used for delivery of such CPAP system. The most commonly used ones are the nasal prongs and nasal mask, and rarely binasopharyngeal prongs or endotracheal tube might also be used. And then there are various types of prongs that are available. So these are the examples of the most commonly one used, the Hudson prongs, which is used with the bubble CPAP system, and the short binasal prongs. These are used with the ventilator CPAP. So both of these are short binasal prongs with length of around 6 to 10 millimeters. So as shorter the prongs would be, least would be the resistance that they would be creating in the airways. So what we intend using it is a short binasal prong, which is supposedly the best interface. Ram's cannula is another type of nasal prong. Actually, it is similar to the oxygen prongs that we use. It just has a wider diameter. So it can reduce the resistance in the inspiratory and the expiratory circuit, but there is not still much evidence regarding the use of this. And then there are Argyll prongs. They might also be used, but then they are slightly difficult to fit into the nasal cavity, and they are difficult to use in active babies. So what is the best interface? There is no conclusive evidence to say that, but apart from talking about nasal masks, there is nothing which is creating resistance in the nasal cavity. So if available, nasal seep masks may be recommended as the primary interface for providing CPAP. Then, how to choose a correct size of cap or interface which is of utmost application, utmost use for a baby who's on CPAP. So, for choosing a correct cap size, there are various guides available along with the caps that are provided. So you can measure the head circumference of the baby and then choose a correct size of cap accordingly. Then for Hudson prongs, they come in 6 different sizes as per the weight of the baby. So you can choose an appropriate one accordingly. For Fisher and Paykel prongs, they provide a size guide, which is actually a transparent sheet where they have demonstrated the size of nostrils and the columella. So you can place it over the baby's nostril and can choose an appropriate one for the baby. So choosing the right size of prongs or a correct interface is very important. While using prong, choosing interface, always remember that CPAP would only be delivered if the prongs that we are using will snugly fit the nasal cavity. It should fill at least 2/3 of the nasal cavity, but at the same time, it should not abut the bridge of the columella, and there should be no blanching of the nose that takes place. So these have to be kept in mind. So when coming on to how is this applied over the baby. So the first thing is that we put a snugly fitting cap. So choosing an appropriate size cap is important. It should be placed so that it crosses above the airway, covers the airs, and then goes on to the back of the neck. And then the nasal interface that we, the tubing or the interface is then adhered to this cap using either pins and rubber bands or using Velcro tapes. Minimizing the pressure leak. So nose and mouth leaks are inherent problems with any type of CPAP delivery systems. So to avoid that, we have already emphasized that use a snugly fitting cap and a snugly fitting nasal prongs. Otherwise, it will not deliver the pressure that we wish to deliver. Then you can use a Velcro mustache over the lips, so to properly fix the interface over the face. And then something about chin straps. So chin straps are not routinely recommended, but it has been seen that when compared the closure of the mouth using a chin strap actually helps to attain pharyngeal pressures which are higher than what are attained when the mouth is open. Again, we can see that a pharyngeal pressure against a set CPAP
I think there is some problem in connection with Dr. Akansha. Dr. Shalabh, you want to?
So,
Dr. Kamsha is back?
No, she's not back.
You can, Dr. Ruchira?
Yeah.
Take some questions of Dr. Akash back first, Beenraj.
Okay, let me do this one second.
Yeah. So the thing is, by the time
you have to switch off one of the speakers somewhere.
Yeah, I'm doing that. Okay. So now by the time Dr. Akanksha is back with us, I think there's some internet connection with her. Let us have some question answer session with Dr. Akash, who is right now, I think, having a proper connection. Dr. Akash, can we go ahead? Dr. Akash?
Yeah, he's there.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Dr. Akash, there's a question from Dr. Vineet Saxena.
Yes, ma'am.
That usually preterm infants are higher risk of getting oxygen injury, higher oxygen, if they are given higher oxygen, risk of oxygen toxicity are high. But Absolutely. Why it is so that preterm infants are resuscitated at higher concentration of oxygen rather than term infants?
What is the guideline is that for preterm babies, you have to start oxygen anywhere between 21% to 30%. They don't say that you resuscitate at higher oxygen concentration. They give a small range because for saturation, the optimal target saturation for preterms is not known. That's why they have given a limit of 10. And there are some studies which have shown that room air, because when they compared that room air 21% with 30%, and they started with 21%, 80% of those babies subsequently went on to have FR to recommend up to 30%. So that's why they have given that range of 21% to 30%, because that is the range in which 90% of the preterm babies will require resuscitation. That is, they will require that much amount of FiO2 to reach their target saturation. That's why they have given a range, and you can always start with room air. They do not say that do not resuscitate with room air. They say that start with 21% to 30%.
Because cost of blender is also quite high, actually. And yeah, sometimes when it is
that cannot be an excuse. We have to use blender, especially if you are doing it. These guidelines, let me remind you that the guidelines are based on very low evidence, and still this dispute is not, it is still not solved. It is a very weak recommendation and very low quality of evidence.
Now, there is another question from Dr. Chaitra. He's telling that in HFNC, 4 to 6 liters flow generates 5 to 6 centimeters pressure.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, she says that my doubt is
please repeat the question, ma'am. There is some...
Ma'am, your voice is breaking.
My voice is breaking?
Yeah, ma'am. Please repeat the question, ma'am.
Okay, just a minute.
Okay, while the question is going on, there is an online... quiz for Dr. Akansha's presentation.
Put the quiz here.
Yeah.
So, question for Dr. Akash was...
Yes, sir.
You said that HFNC pressure should be between 4 to 6 liters.
Flow, yes, sir. Flow of 4 to 6.
Yes. But understanding from Dr. Chaitra is that it should be 4 to 6 liter per kg body weight per minute.
No, sir. Not per kg.
It's It is very simple.
It is flow rate of 4 to 6 liters per minute, not per kg.
Otherwise, if 3 kg flow can be 18 liter to 40. So, one question from Dr. Sachin.
Yes, sir.
How to prevent leak from mouth during HFNC?
We don't need to prevent leak. Because majority of the times, whether it is HFNC or CPAP, if the baby is opening mouth or if the baby is crying, that means that baby is having discomfort. Either because of the pain, because the prongs are not appropriate, or there is a wet diaper which needs to be removed, or baby is hungry. Majority of the babies, when they are on optimal settings, they will be quiet and they will have their mouth open. They will have their mouth closed.
Okay.
And that leak for HFNC, leak from nose and mouth is required for washing out of that CO2. So you don't need to close. It will be more harmful. There will be, because CPAP, we have to remember that CPAP works on pressure, HFNC works on flow. Irrespective of the pressure generated by the HFNC, the ventilation oxygenation mechanisms are different. It works by washing out of the dead space. That is the main mechanism. And for that, you need to have, it is an open system. It is not a closed system like CPAP. And for HFNC to work best, you need to have leak both at around nose as well as mouth. If you close mouth, there will be less CO2 wash out, which is the main mechanism of action for HFNC.
Question from Dr. Gaurav is, can we use a simple oxyset, disposable simple oxyset attached to inspiratory limb of a CPAP to make HFNC?
If you use a simple nasal prong, it will not be adequately heated. And there may be kinking which can interrupt the flow. Quality of an HFNC cannula is that it has got a heating wire even up to the nostrils, whereas in CPAP, that is not there. So it may, if you use a simple cannula, the resistance may be high because normally HFNC circuit is a breathable circuit. Its compliance is good. Whereas if you use a normal oxygen cannula, it will not lead to the adequate warmidification of the gases and it may lead to increased resistance, thereby interrupting the flow. Whatever circuits we are using for HFNC, they are special circuits. They are breathable circuits with good compliance and they maintain the heating of the gas almost up to the nostrils.
So Dr. Akash, there is a question from Dr. Vinny Saxena again. Yes. That you said that when we do the decrement of oxygen flow, then it has to be at the rate of 1 liter every 12 hourly.
Yeah,
and can, what should be the rate of increment when we are increasing it?
Increasing
from
five, it has to be 10 to 15 minutes. For increment, you have to start with stand with the baby, and within 5 to 10 minutes, you can increase. For increasing, you don't need to wait for 8 to 12 hours. You have to increase every 5 to 10 minutes if there is a persistent respiratory distress.
And Dr. Rohit is asking that what is the most cost effective HFNC right now?
The most cost effective is the CPAP machine which you are using for CPAP. You use the same machine for giving HFNC. Only thing is, if you want an Indian made, the Indian made nasal cannula for HFNC are available for 500 to 600 rupees.
Okay. So Dr. Gaurav is asking, can we use simple oxyset attached to inspiratory limb?
This we have answered, ma'am.
Again, the repetition. How much flow can be given to the baby?
8 liters is the maximum flow.
That is maximum. HFNC versus CPAP. What is more friendly to nurses and parents? Definitely, you had explained it in your talk. It was HFNC.
The TRP of HFNC is that it is all friendly. Be it a baby, be it a staff, or be it a mother. That is the main advantage of using HFNC.
So, Dr. Akash, Dr. Prateek is asking this question. Can a bubble CPAP be used for HFNC? If yes, then what other accessories do we need to buy for CPAP?
I think we have answered it, but for the sake of maybe he has missed. Yes, we can use the same CPAP machine which is used to deliver CPAP for HFNC. Only thing is that you have to remove the expiratory limb and you have to connect the inspiratory limb with OptiFlow. That is, you only need to buy the HFNC cannulae and you need to connect it to the inspiratory limb.
Okay.
And flows and FiO2 can be titrated just like we do for CPAP.
So Dr. Akash, there's another question from Dr. Yusuf, and he's asking that how much flow per kg of baby's weight to be used for HFNC? Is weight a factor in deciding HFNC flow in preterm units?
First of all, regarding flow can be used from 2 to 8 liters. That is what 1 to 8 liters, or some books say even 2 to 8 liters. It is not per kg. But you need to remember that the same flow, suppose for example 6 liter in a 1 kg baby will generate higher pressures compared to a term baby which is around 3 to 4 kgs.
And
one thing for the clarification of the audience, I need to say that whenever you are giving HFNC, you cannot control the pressure, neither you can measure the pressure. So for whenever you are giving HFNC, the main thing you have to concentrate on is flow. Don't worry about pressures. You neither can set them, you neither can measure them.
So there are some circuits available with heated wire up to the nostrils.
Yeah, that is the HFNC.
Take on this. I mean, they are supposed to be good ones.
See, the Indians are known for Jugaad system. Something is better than nothing.
Again, and Jugaad.
Yeah, but if you talk about the evidence, none of the machines which has been made in India has been tested so far. But definitely, if there is nothing, you can use those indigenous cannula. And in fact, we should do research with our own system, with our own machines, and generate the data.
So Dr. Akash, a 32-weeker is born.
Yes, ma'am.
And is having a respiratory distress, maybe mild respiratory distress. Now, what should I start with? He's a 32-weeker baby. Now, CPAP or HFNC?
First, ma'am, if
my resident is saying he go for CPAP, what should I do?
If, ma'am, you are working in a tertiary center where you have good nursing to patient ratio, there is always a doctor available 24/7. Best is to start CPAP. But if you are working in a small center where there is not enough manpower, there is not enough nursing staff, there are plenty of babies which are to be looked after, there you can use HFNC and monitor the baby every 2 to 3 hourly. And in case if you think that despite adequate settings, baby is not being managed properly, his distress, his work of breathing is increasing, you can always switch to CPAP.
So if there is a resource limited setting, then one should go for HFNC in such kind of scenario. One should look for CPAP. So you feel CPAP
is for primary support, there's no doubt that CPAP is better. But if you are working in a small center, there is CPAP machine is not available, the manpower is not available, the nursing staff is not there to monitor, then you can always give a trial of HFNC. A baby who is more than 32 weeks.
Ruchira, you can, Akash is here, you can transfer question sent for Akansha to Akash. Ruchira start, ye bhi kuch jugaad wala hai.
Yes, sir. The
circuits of CPAPs are very costly.
Yes, sir.
Whole set of Fisher-Paykel cost about
4,000-5,000. Yes.
So, isme kya jugaad ho sakta hai?
So, there are, first of all, you can, reusable circuits are available. We can reuse them. Second thing is, you can use Indian-made circuits. Like there are N number of, there is Phoenix, there is FlexiCare. They are available on around 600 to 700 cost. You can use them, sir.
So they are compatible with Fisher and Paykel humidifier and all.
They can be with some minor jugaad. They are compatible.
So
Dr. Akash, this is a question from Dr. Vikas, and he's asking that CPAP in preterm versus term babies. Your expert remark about it.
Ma'am, for preterm babies, we need to understand that the major cause of respiratory distress is atelectasis. That is, during expiration, the alveoli tend to remain collapsed. That is because of the surfactant deficiency. So any baby with preterm, any preterm baby with respiratory distress, CPAP is the choice. There is no other way. CPAP plus minus surfactant. But for a term baby, if he is not having severe retractions, one can use other modalities of oxygen therapy like Hood box oxygen, because there the problem is not atelectasis. Majority of the time it is either meconium aspiration or pneumonia. So for preterm baby, respiratory distress, always CPAP with or without surfactant, depending on the severity. For term baby, you may use CPAP, but even a Hood box oxygen can do.
Now you're taking both the questions on both the topics, and usually the questions are overlapping also when we are discussing these things, HFNC and CPAP. So there's a question from Dr. Arvind Gul that what are the similarities between HFNC and CPAP?
Similarities are that both are non-invasive. That is the major similarity.
Very good question from Dr. Ghazi.
What is the percentage of term baby with mild to moderate distress stabilized on HFNC, and the percentage of baby who was initially on HFNC and later shifted to CPAP? Is there any study, any statistics?
Yes. Can you repeat the questions?
See, the question is, what is the percentage of term babies with mild to moderate respiratory distress stabilized on HFNC, and percentage of babies who required rescue CPAP or other measurements? Do you have any percentage
Yes, ma'am. I personally know a unit, various units, especially countries. In Italy, there are n number of units which do not use CPAP at all for term babies. They give results of around 90% of the term babies, 90 to 95% of the baby. They can be managed on HFNC alone. And even for data is not from the term babies, but data is from the preterm babies. One is the Hipster trial and other is the Murki et al. Trial, which was a collaborative trial between Fernandez and Surya Hospital. There they have shown that babies, even the preterm babies who fail HFNC, they can be managed on CPAP. And the need for ventilation in both the groups, that is HFNC and CPAP, was similar, because babies who failed HFNC, they went on CPAP and were managed on CPAP. They did not require ventilation. So if preterm babies who fail HFNC can be managed on CPAP, same applies. I don't think it should be a problem for term babies.
I think, Dr. Ghazi, your question is answered.
Dr. Akash, what are the experiences of CPAP in HIE baby and MAS babies?
CPAP for HIE babies, first of all, I will answer HIE. If it is a severe HIE, there the problem is not within the lungs. It is the brain. The neuronal circuit is not intact, so dry will not be there. So majority of these babies will get intubated in the delivery room itself. For mild HIE, the results are very high, almost 90%. Coming back to the meconium aspiration syndrome, I think I have done enough work on meconium aspiration. The largest trial is by me. It is published in JAMA Pediatrics. Whereby we have shown that meconium aspiration, if it is mild to moderate, majority of the babies, that is 75% of the babies, can be managed on CPAP alone. And for every 5 babies you put on CPAP, you are going to prevent 1 ventilation.
Now, Dr. Akash, post-extubation, this is a question from Dr. Sandeep. He's asking, post-extubation, which kind of setting do you prefer, putting the baby on HFNC or CPAP?
That is the only condition where HFNC has been shown to be similar to CPAP. So post-extubation, either you shift him to CPAP or HFNC, it is your will. But the caution is only for the extreme premature babies. Less than 28 weeks, you should shift to CPAP. For babies who are more than 28 weeks, if you are starting HFNC, the initial rates have to be similar. That is a flow of 4 to 6 liters, and FiO2 is equivalent to the one which he was receiving on the ventilator.
So Any study on missed with HFNC in extremely low birth weight babies?
There is an as of now the results are not published, but there is an ongoing trial where they have studying the missed along with the HFNC. But as of now, there is no trial.
So what is this? What are these terminologies, Dr. Akash? Missed, Lisa, and
actually these are
surfactant, X-ray, insert. What are these? Insure. What are these terminologies? Can you please explain them?
Sure, ma'am. In the previous, when the RDS started in 1960s, 1950s, majority of the clinicians, they thought that the only way to treat RDS is mentate, right in the delivery room itself. Then subsequently, Gregory et al., they did a landmark trial. We showed that if you put a baby on CPAP, you are going to salvage 50% of the babies. So the CPAP began to be used as an initial mode of respiratory support. But the babies who required surfactant, the only way to give surfactant in those era was to intubate, give surfactant, and then give a short period of ventilation for around 30 minutes, and then extubate them back to CPAP. That is what was called as INSURE. That is intubate, give surfactant, ventilate them for 30 minutes, and then extubate to CPAP. Now, as we know, despite various strategies, open lung concept, caffeine, non-invasive ventilation, the incidence of BPD did not decrease. It is still high, despite various revolutionary measures and despite non-invasive being promoted left and right. So what they thought that maybe because the animal studies demonstrated that even if you give 5 to 6 positive breaths, it is enough to cause lung injury. So since in while giving surfactant with the help of ET tube, we need give bag and mask, and those pressures are transmitted to the lungs. Second thing is whenever we are giving insure, if the baby is on CPAP, we have to remove CPAP. So whatever recruitment of the lung we have achieved, we are allowing the lungs to de-recruit. And second thing is we are intubating and giving positive pressure ventilation. To overcome these invasive methods, there was development of non-invasive technique of giving surfactant, which in fact is a misnomer because LISA, MIST, they are not really non-invasive. They are partially invasive. So MIST is a term by Europe and LISA is a term which was given by US. LISA means least invasive surfactant administration and MIST means minimally invasive surfactant technique. And there is also another term called take care. To avoid this confusion, we have given a classification which is known as, which is published and it is known as Pandita's classification, where we have used a common term for all these terms so that there is no confusion. And we call it as SURE. Sure and insure. By sure, we mean that surfactant without endotracheal intubation. So it covers every method. And the last, what actually should be least invasive is when the surfactant is given by nebulization. That is the real non-invasive way of giving surfactant.
Okay, thank you for explaining very nicely. There's one more interesting question. They said, this is a question from Dr. Neeraj, and he's asking, can you suggest how to make a CPAP in case the machine isn't available or so as to start in a delivery room?
There are for indigenous CPAP, again, it is an indigenously jugaad, although they have not been studied, but again, something is better than nothing. The videos, because it will require a demonstration of the videos are freely available in YouTube. If there is not one, we'll send shortly in one in the group and we'll circulate. It is difficult to show demonstrate here.
Okay. So you feel that one can use those indigenous systems?
We do not promote it, but if you don't have any avenues you are working
with, there, one can use it at that
But
time.
If you have nothing, you want to use something, you can make an indigenous.
So there's one more question which has come up and just like... this doctor says that I'm living in a very small city or rather a small town and we don't have much of the facilities here, but then there are so many patients who come with respiratory distress and all that. So I am planning to buy a CPAP machine for me. So now he says that I've got two options. One is that I should buy a ventilator machine, in which already you see CPAP options there. So it will serve me as a purpose for ventilation as well. Whereas there's another option which in which I should buy only CPAP machine. So what is your suggestion?
What is the amount he can buy? Only one ventilator, or he can buy multiple?
Right now he can buy only one thing, one machine only.
So for him, it is, I think the better option is to buy a ventilator only, because even for preterm babies, VLBW babies, 50% of the babies will fail CPAP and they will require intubation. So if he has money to buy two or three ventilators, then he should buy 50% of the CPAP machines or maybe one ventilator with the rest of the money, because each ventilator nowadays costs around 15 to 20 lakhs, whereas CPAP machine just costs around 1 to 2 lakhs.
What is the cost, most cost effective HHFMC machine right now?
It is the same CPAP machine which you are using, the same CPAP machine you can use for HHFMC. The cost of an individual HFNC machine right now is around 3 to 5 lakhs.
Akash, two questions on post-extubation.
Yes, sir.
Which is the best modality for a post-extubation patient, NIV or HFNC?
If it is a preterm baby less than 28 weeker, NIV, more than 28 weeker, both are equally good.
So for an extubated patient, ventilatory CPAP is better, or one should go for bubble CPAP?
Both ventilator or bubble CPAP. It is, if you have both, better to use bubble CPAP and keep ventilator reserved for a baby who requires ventilation.
And otherwise, Dr. Akash, what does the study show that
There is no difference. Only thing is, if you are putting a baby on ventilator CPAP, you are occupying the ventilator. Whereas if you're using a CPAP machine, that ventilator can be used for a baby who goes on to develop need for ventilation.
Dr. Akash, the interface which has been used for CPAP, and as Dr. Akanksha said, that nasal mask is considered to be better interface in case if it is there. But most of the places not available, then which one next do you suggest?
We know that neonates are nasal obligate breathers. So anything, if you put in the nose, it is going to increase the resistance and increase the work of breathing. Whenever you are giving a mask, you are not occluding the nares. So that's why nasal mask is the best. But if you don't have a nasal mask, short binasal prongs is the second best option.
Now, if somebody does not have nasal prongs, and somehow it's not available, even nasal mask is not there, nasal prongs are also not there. Is there again any jugar thing which
endotracheal, ma'am? We can use endotracheal tube for giving.
So the size, what will be the size? Will it be the same as that of oral, or again, will there be any
again,
difference?
Again, we have to measure it from the nasals to the tragus.
The diameter.
Yes, ma'am.
Or it just usually one size smaller is considered to be better. Okay.
Usually when we intubate from the mouth, but here you are using it through the nose. So if the smaller, we are using the same distance, it will not reach. It will be slightly above. But again, it should be used for a short term. It is not for a long term.
Okay. And does CPAP really predispose the child for sepsis?
No, ma'am. If you are meticulous in your nursing care, it does not predispose to sepsis. However, we should remember, any procedure, any invasion we do for a baby, if we are not careful, we are not meticulous, we are not taking care of sepsis, we are not taking care of hand hygiene, even touching a baby can lead to sepsis.
Is Akanksha ready? Can we stop discussion here? Vinay?
Yeah, okay. She's ready.
Yes, sir. Dr. Akanksha, I have given you rights to host. You can start.
I think my system meeting got disconnected and I didn't realize that.
No worries.
Finish off the rest part fast.
Go ahead.
So may I know where did I got disconnected?
When you were
interface.
Okay.
Yeah, the one with the
27, slide 27.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll try to finish it fast. So with any CPAP delivery system, nose and mouth leaks are the inherent problems. So to avoid that, use a snugly fitting cap, a snugly fitting nasal prong, and Velcro mustache can be used to appropriately fix the CPAP over the nasal cavity. Other than that is chin strap, which is which might be used, not though not routinely recommended, but it is safe. It has been seen even in studies that the pharyngeal pressure that is attained when the mouth is closed using a chin strap is much higher than what is achieved with a open mouth. Similarly here, that the when the mouth is closed, higher pressures are attained. Though it is not routinely recommended to use, but in case the baby is very irritating or you're not able to achieve adequate bubbling, even at flows of 7 to 8 liters per minute, you can consider using a chin strap. Next, coming on to the CPAP care, apart from the correct interfaces, the care of the nares is a must. Proper oral and nasal suctioning is required. Frequent installation of saline drops, put in orogastric tube so that any swallowed air can be vented out to the atmosphere. And if the baby is on feeds, just close it for 20 to 30 minutes after feeds. Developmental supportive care and KMC can be continued with even with CPAP. And because nasal trauma is the most common complication of CPAP, so do look for it very meticulously. Make a scoring chart wherein every 2 to 4 hourly, look for the signs of any hyperemia or blanching of the nose. Otherwise, it will result in varying degrees of nasal injury. Then coming on to the indications, there are various indications as listed here, starting from RDS to delivery room resuscitation, then post-extubation, management of babies, apnea of prematurity. But the dictum is that use CPAP for any baby with respiratory, any preterm baby with respiratory distress and retractions in grunting. But the prerequisite is that there should be good spontaneous respiratory efforts. And even the NNF-CPG guidelines of January 2020 provide strong recommendations for use of CPAP in all these settings. Our very own HOD sir was a part of the review committee of these guidelines. So the most common indication, as we all know, is RDS. But how to optimize the CPAP? So there is a rule of 5 which says that start with a pressure of 5 centimeters of water, because these pressure, FiO2 and flow, these are the adjustable settings while the baby is on CPAP. So adjust the pressure, start with the pressure of 5 and then adjust it to minimize the chest retractions and attain in proper inflation of 6 to 8 rib spaces. For FiO2, start with 5 as per the rule of 5, start at 50% and then titrate to maintain a target saturation. For flow, start with 5 liters of flow and then adjust it to ensure continuous bubbling in case of bubble CPAP. For ventilator, CPAP and IFD, the flow is usually constant at around 4 to 8 liters per minute. And while the baby is being on CPAP, monitor him continuously for signs of clinical improvement in form of a comfortable breathing, no retractions in grunting, normalization of blood gases, optimum saturations, and radiological improvement. When the lung, the disease process improves, consider weaning the baby off CPAP. So it is said if the baby is on a FiO2 of more than 50% and a pressure of more than 5 centimeters, so wean the FiO2 first in steps of 5% every 15 to 30 minutes. And once you've come down to FiO2s of around 30%, then start weaning the pressure by 1 centimeter each. And but reduce, wean the pressure very slowly every 4 to 6 hourly, keeping a strict watch on the respiratory pattern of the baby. You can wean the baby to room air, or if you do not feel it appropriate, that there is some pressure still required for the baby, so we can consider weaning to HHFMC. So once the baby is on a pressure of 4 centimeters and a FiO2 requirement is less than 25%. But post CPAP, do have a strict watch on retractions or any apneas. If restart, if any of these occur. Failure of CPAP is if there is a persistent FiO2 requirement more than 60 to 70%, even on a CPAP of 7 centimeters of water with persistent respiratory acidosis, hypercarbia, and recurrent apnea. But before labeling a failure of CPAP and moving on to upscaling the support, do ensure that the interface that you chose was correctly fixed. There is proper humidification which was occurring. There is no blockage of the air cavity and the neck is properly positioned. Another indication of using CPAP is delivery room CPAP, wherein the device used to deliver this is a TPS resuscitator, where we start at around a flow rate of 8 to 10 liters per minute and we set a PIP of around 15 to 20 and a peak of around 3 to 5 centimeters of water. Using CPAP early in the delivery room has been shown to prevent atelectasis, conserve the surfactant and minimize the stimulation of inflammatory cascade. So start early. In cases of apnea of prematurity, it is indicated when the methylxanthine therapy fails and it has been shown to decrease the frequency of apnea episodes. Start at pressures of around 4 and remove if the baby is apnea free for 24 to 48 hours. Post extubation, there has already been a prolonged discussion on that, but CPAP is indicated in post-extubation scenarios and it has been shown to decrease the extubation rates of extubation failure, and also there's a trend to decrease incidence of PPD in babies who were extubated to CPAP. Meconium aspiration syndrome, this is a tricky situation because herein the lung has a variegated pathology. Some of the alveoli are collapsed while the others are overinflated, and we all know that such a baby is at a high risk of air leaks. So use it, you have to be extra vigilant for looking for signs of air leak while using it for a baby with MAS. Avoid using pressures more than 6 centimeters of water. Try to keep it at 4 to 5 and FiO2 of around 50%. There has been a study where they studied the effect of nasal CPAP on babies with MAS, and they found that there was a significantly reduced need of mechanical ventilation and need for surfactant in babies who were treated with CPAP in their initial hours of life. What complications we can expect and we have to watch for? Over-distension of lung, air leaks or pneumothorax, we have to be watchful for that. Decreased cardiac output due to increased intrathoracic pressure can take place, or as we already see, because of reduced FRC, there can be increased pulmonary vascular resistance. Gastric distension and CPAP belly syndrome, which can be taken care of by inserting an orogastric tube. Nasal trauma is the most common complication, and even there's a facial palsy that has been observed in some of our babies, maybe because of compression of nerve at the stylomastoid foramen, and this is a case series which has been published in BMJ. Contraindications is if the baby is unable to maintain oxygenation and the CO2s are rising, if there is any congenital malformations of the airway like corneal atresia, TEF or CDH, where there would be inadequate and delivery of the CPAP, if there is severe cardiovascular instability or a poor respiratory rate, do not use a CPAP then. Then next advancement to that is just a word about BiPAP or DuoPAP, which is a recent. Actually, what BiPAP does is it is a type of CPAP, but where we are providing two levels of PEEP, one high and one low, during the respiratory cycle at a set rate. So it actually helps by being more physiological, because when the baby is having less effort, it will be supported by the lesser pressure, and the more pressures, if the drive is poor, then it will be supported by the higher pressure. So it is more closer to effects that are achieved are more similar to those with conventional ventilation. So it is expected to provide a higher mean airway pressure and a better lung recruitment, which will result in increased tidal volume and reduced work of breathing. There is not much studies which have been done on use of DuoPAP in units, but there is an ongoing trial at our institute where we are comparing the need for mechanical ventilation in two groups of preterm units less than 35 weeks with RDS who will be receiving CPAP versus BiPAP. We hope to be available with the results soon. Next is, we cannot skip the times of corona. So in this pandemic where we might very soon fall short of the ventilators and the respiratory support devices. So this is just our indigenous strategy, innovative strategy that we have made, where we have we are splitting the bubble CPAP assembly so that that we can use it a single assembly for providing CPAP to two babies in case there is shortage of the machines or the situation worsens as we are already seeing. So we are using the T2 splitter for that. Though further experience and more testing observation is required once it is being put into the practice. Also, what we recommend is using a head box in infants with CPAP, especially at times of this corona where there is, we have to prevent the exposure to the aerosols which might be generated with the use of CPAP. So we recommend using a head box to cover the upper torso of such infants. So this is a CPAP assembly wherein we have used a TP splitter, and the pressure that is being delivered is optimum or not. We have used pressure manometers at the expiratory tubings of both the circuits. So this is something we are aiming at. Then the take-home messages will be that it is one of the most effective and gentle way of providing respiratory support to neonates. And there are very limited centers, just about few medical colleges, maybe some training centers or some referral centers where mechanical ventilation is available. So CPAP can act as a simple and a cost-effective intervention in resource-limited settings. But apart from that, a good antenatal care, wherein we give a high antenatal steroid coverage, timely referral, and optimum delivery, use of optimum delivery and newborn care practices is a must to get the most out of the benefits of CPAP. So I would like to stop here. My acknowledgements to all the neonates, my HOD sir, faculty, the organizers, and the dear colleagues. Thank you. If there are any questions still left?
Yes, yes. Before Ruchira is coming with question, first of all, Akansha, our apology for the interruption because it was beyond your efforts and our technical support. So this thing happening.
Yes, sometimes. Sir. But I'm thankful that you allowed me to complete my session.
My question is, apnea is an indication for CPAP.
Yes.
And if a baby is free from apnea for 24 hours, you can withhold or discontinue CPAP. On the other hand, in a resource-limited setting where there is no resident to look for, person like me does not dare to keep baby of apnea on CPAP. But even then, what are the settings? What are the apnea alarms after that? You think that this baby is not fit for CPAP and we should shift it on mechanical ventilation?
Okay. So actually for apnea of prematurity, if for any use of CPAP, spontaneous respiratory efforts must be present. But then it is said that in some apneas, wherein that the frequency of apneas are less, or we our clinical gut and
any cutoff ki kya matlab kitni bar apnea ho jaye, any cutoff ki kab aap decide karoge ki
the apneas are that are happening are more than 4 in an hour, so that is a failure of CPAP and we must consider shifting the baby to upgrading our respiratory support. For such babies, it is no use continuing them on CPAP if they are having such frequent episodes of apnea.
Dr. Akanksha,
yes,
there's a question that about the role of CPAP in meconium aspiration syndrome.
Yes.
How to optimize PEEP in MAS in absence of chest X-ray? Don't know how atelectatic or hyperinflation lung visual. This is from Dr. Sachin.
Actually, ma'am, as I already stated, that using it in meconium aspiration syndrome is a very tricky situation. And I already told that it should not be used in wherein you cannot monitor for the signs of overdistension. So being extra vigilant when you are using CPAP for babies with meconium aspiration syndrome is a must. ठीक है, वी विल स्टार्ट विद लोअर प्रेशर्स, वी विल कीप देम अराउंड लेस देन 6, बट देन इफ यू द क्लिनिकल इंडिकेटर्स दैट कैन बी यूज आर द सेम एज दोज फॉर अदर प्रीटर्म बेबीज, दैट द बेबी इज comfortable, there are no retractions, there is no sudden change in the work of breathing which will indicate towards an air leak, the baby is not desaturating, the perfusions are good, so they might indicate that there is no air leak at present, but then you have to be very careful while using this. And my personal recommendation is if you cannot monitor for the signs or cannot be extra vigilant to look for the signs of air leak, you should avoid using it then. It should only be done with very meticulous and very vigilant monitoring of for looking for signs of over-distension, because the pathology is very variegated. We do not know how much alveoli are collapsed. We do not know how much alveoli are over-distended. So in those scenarios, the only thing can be that look for the signs of air leaks that we do for in any baby. If there is a decreased chest movement, if there is an increase in the AP diameter, one side, the chest movements on one side are reduced, there is no air entry, there is a resonant note on percussion, the baby is desaturating. So all these will be indications of air leak in such baby. But then be cautious.
So if you have to reuse Fisher-Paykel CPAP circuit,
yes, ma'am.
Dr. Harpreet is asking, what is the better way to sterilize it in between two patients?
Actually, the best is that you use the disposable circuit, that you get a new one for every baby. But then this is not always practically possible. So what you have to do is we can get after every, whenever we change the patient, but after using it for every baby, we need to sterilize it either by getting it ETO, and then only it can be reused for the another baby without proper sterilization. If that is not available and if it is in dire emergency, we can consider putting it into a Sidex for around with a contact period of around 1 hour. But that is not which is desirable. If you are using a reusable circuit, then better to get it sterilized by your hospital and then reuse it for another baby. And for the same patient, it is unless until the circuit is visibly soiled, there is no need to change the circuit.
And Dr. Akanksha, how frequently one should do suctioning in cases of nasal when they are giving oxygen support nasal cannula versus nasopharyngeal cannula?
Ma'am, for CPAP, we do not say that suction it frequently, but then you do have to good a very you do have to do a very good nasal care. So it is said as and when you see that there are secretions which are causing the blockage of the airway, we can do suctioning maybe 4 hourly, 2 to 4 hourly. 2 hourly is that you to avoid causing the blockage of secretions and the frequent need of suctioning. It is said that you use instillation of saline drops into the nasal cavity every 2 hourly maybe, so that the nasal, if the nasal cavity is kept moist and we are using the gases at optimum humidification and optimum temperatures, there would not be much chances of getting the airway blocked. But as and when the secretions are there, do suctioning maybe 4 to 6 hourly can be done.
So, Dr. Akanksha, I feel if it is nasal cannula, then one can see the secretions there. And when one sees the secretion, one can do the suctioning. Yes. But if we are using nasopharyngeal cannula, then usually it is blocking the whole thing and one is not able to see the secretion. And in that case, you will have to take out the thing and every 4 hourly at least one must do suctioning.
Major problem why nasopharyngeal prongs are now getting out of practice, because once with them there is a high resistance which is provided, so it might actually result in a work of breathing, and they very frequently the problem with them is that they get blocked with the airway secretion. So managing them with managing CPAP on them is quite troublesome. So probably the preferred ones.
And the last question, because there are so many questions actually, unfortunately, because of this technical fault, we missed out onto that. But this is the last question, because now it's already 2 hours we have spent, and we even didn't come to know that time has passed this much. So this is the last question. Now, can we reuse the same nasal prompts?
Ideally not. But then, as I said, that it is ideal is not always feasible in our scenarios. So we can, after cleaning them, once you take it, want to use it for the other baby, clean them with saline, and you have to again get it sterilized. If not sterilized, then put it in Cydex for at least a contact period of at least 20 minutes to 1 hour, and then you can reuse it for other babies as well.
And in the same baby, for how long can we use the same, for how many days can we use the same prong, nasal prong? When should we change it rather?
Ma'am, there's no clear-cut recommendation that after this many days you should change it. But it is ideally said maybe if the baby is on prolonged CPAP for around 7 to 10 days, you can consider changing the nasal prongs, as the risk of sepsis also might increase if we keep using the same prong.
Thank you, Dr. Akanksha. Thank you, Dr. Akash, for clarifying all the doubts and giving the wonderful presentations and deliberations. Thank you, audience. Dr. Shalabh.
Thank you, Dr. Ruchira, for perfectly moderating the session. And I compliment both the speakers. And what about tomorrow? We'll start again the time. Today, the delay was because of the Prime Minister's address and a technical fault, but I think we have made up. And I request both the esteemed speakers, can they share some videos in the groups? Two requests. One, can they share the videos of the procedure, how to apply the HHMC and the CPAP correctly, maybe for the benefit of the beginners, how to make the perfect interface. And another, that the remaining questions, we request them to answer them on the WhatsApp group.
Sure, sir. We'll do that.
So with this, we end with the session today, and tomorrow we have a very important session of ABG and NIB.
So that thank you everyone for joining in today. We will again meet at 8:30 tomorrow. Thanks, Dr. Akash. Thanks, Dr. Akanksha.
Thanks for your time.
No worries. Thanks to all the participants. I think we had 80% people changing their names today to their unique ID, which is good. Really appreciate that. And I'll see you tomorrow. Till then, take care. Good night.
Bye.